guys, welcome to Trinity Church Online. For more information, please visit us at ourtrinity.org, or you can find us on Facebook at Trinity Church of Wheat Ridge, or even on Instagram at Trinity Church CO. No matter where you are today, we are glad that you have joined us here.
Worship team went skiing yesterday, and so if we're all up here like Quincy, it's probably because we're all sore. But put that to the side. I was praying beforehand, and I was like, you know what? Let's pray the Lord will give us strength for the next hour or so. And I pray that this next hour of worship will just be great. So let's turn our hearts towards God. Let's stand and worship Him together.
Christ.
I'm glad that you are here this morning. Welcome to Trinity Church. I'm Pastor Derek. I'm the assistant pastor here. And if you are new here, there should be a card in the chair in front of you. If you wouldn't mind filling that out, it's just kind of a communication card letting us know that you are here. And if you have any questions about wanting some information, we can reach out to you and give that to you. So I just got a couple quick announcements. The first one being is the outreach team has asked me to let you know that they do not need donations right now. They have a lot, which is great. I mean, we've been very giving. You guys have been bringing in things. Praise the Lord for that. That's an awesome thing. But we are running out of space to keep all of it. So let's hold back on some donations right now. We'll wait until we get news about where they can put everything, because right now I think it's just kind of going to creep into the church, the rest of the places, and we're going to run out of rooms eventually. So, but yeah, if you've been donating to that, we appreciate it. Thank you very much. But we're going to hold off a little bit on that for right now. The next one is we do have our annual meeting on February 21st. That will be at the 9 a.m. hour. So instead of Sunday school class, we're going to be doing our annual meeting, and that will be in the sanctuary here. So on February 21st, come prepared for that. We'll just be kind of giving some of the staff some reports over this last year, kind of what we look forward to in this next year, and then just some information, and you'll receive the annual report from all of our leaders as well. And then the last one being is, I believe next Sunday we're starting our series in Judges. And that is going to be an exciting series for sure. How many of you have read the book of Judges before? Probably a lot of you. If you have not, man, you're in for a ride. This is a great book. It's a very interesting book, and it's kind of a scary book in some ways. And so some of the things, and so just think about what I'm going to be talking about during that time. So, but yeah, those are some things that we can look forward to. So let's continue in worship as we sing these next songs. These next two songs, they really focus on Christ rising from the grave. And isn't that that's extremely important. That's probably one of the most important things to our belief, right? If Jesus died and stayed in the grave, he was just another human, right? He wasn't a savior, but in fact, he rose again from the grave. And because of that, we can when we sing out to him, we're not singing to some dead entity. We're singing to God. We are singing to a living savior. And so as I pray, let's think about those songs as we sing those. So please stand with me. Father God, we thank you for loving this world enough to send your son to die for it. We were not deserved of that. God, your grace is so amazing for us and to us, God. I pray that you will just help us to worship you in these songs. Help us to lift up your son's name as we worship the Savior that we have. And it's in his name we pray, Jesus. Amen. Still and all alone.
where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing Your praise. Oh, Lord our God. He shall return in robes of white. The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
Turn on.
throughout eternity, your song will be the same. And hallelujah, Christ is risen from the grave. And hallelujah, Christ is risen from the grave.
Amen. Amen. We thank you, Jesus, for coming down to this earth and saving us. We thank you for sacrificing yourself. We praise you for your grace. We thank you because you rose again and you ascended into heaven now that we can be filled with the Holy Spirit. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, church. I don't do this very often, but I'm going to share something with you, and then we'll get into the message because I think it ties in beautifully. I woke up this morning about 3 o'clock, and I don't put a lot of stock into dreams, but I had a dream. And in this dream, I was in this huge hall of world leaders, and they were talking about future and the direction of where the world was going. And it sounded pretty good at first. But then I began to notice a change. And this leadership began to transform. And they became very dark, satanic, demonic. And I was trying to call it out, but the audience wasn't listening. So I remember walking to the front of that great hall. I said, a battle is coming. A great battle is coming. And at first, it may not look like we as Christians are going to win. But I tell you all out there, we're going to win. We're going to win. And as I thought about that, I said, Lord, how am I going to tie that into the message? He said, you just start preaching, I'll tie it in. So we'll see how he's going to tie that in, but I think he will. Because there's a point in this message where we have got to be challenged to be immersed in the Word of God, to be immersed in prayer. And we've been talking on this whole series about God with us, the Emmanuel principle, and the reality of what it would mean if God, if we really lived in light of the fact that God is really with us every day. And wherever we go, God is going there because the Holy Spirit's in us. So whether we think we're taking God there or not, he is with us and he is going with us. And we looked at the manifestations that should be reflected in love and acceptance and in forgiveness. That has to be the cornerstone of what's going on in the church, and that's what the world needs, love, acceptance, and forgiveness. And then we moved on to the fact that the church is not the field. It's not where all the work of God is done. The field is the world. And we have to find a way to not let the world affect us, but us to go engage the community and the world and transform it. So that brings us to our final message. This is the last message in this series. As Derek said, we're going to start in on Judges next week. And boy, if there is a book for this time of age in which we live, Judges is the book. I mean, it is going to be point on, spot on for us. So I would really encourage you, and if you're out there listening on the computer, whatever you're doing today, I want you to make sure that you tell your friends to tune in on Judges, because I think it will fit into this dream that I had. But today we're looking at the church must equip, and the church must release. It must equip people for ministry, equip them to serve. I'll never forget going to Maxine's mother's Lucy's service there at Fort Logan. And at a point in that service, they had what they call the releasing of the doves. Now, the thing that was a beautiful expression. But you see, those doves had to be trained. Those doves had to be equipped to know exactly when to leave that cage, when to make the formations they made, and then to find their way back home. Without any training or releasing, that would have never worked. And I want to suggest to you that the church cannot be a force. It cannot love and accept and forgive. It cannot be God with us if it's not equipped and released. Let's pray. Father, you've come to us. We don't have to go looking. You found us. You came seeking and saving the lost. And Father, we're needing to challenge the church today. And the challenge isn't mine, it's yours. It's from your word, it's from your scripture. And Lord, as we open up this word today, may that word speak to us. May we find ourselves immersed in this word to the point that even without it, if it was taken away from us, we could speak it and its principles. In Jesus' name, amen. So, as believers, not only are we equipped, we're continuously being equipped to serve and released to minister. And we need to be equipped and realize, first of all, we're equipped in the Spirit. And second, we're equipped in the Word of God. So let's go look at the first thing we want to look at and follow along in our notes. We are equipped in the Spirit. Let's go to Acts chapter 2, beginning with verse 38. This little verse comes at the end of Peter's message. Remember, at the end of that message, thousands respond to it. But many of them want to know what they need to do. And so he tells them here in verse 38 of Acts chapter 2. Then Peter said to them, "Repent, let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ." That's the receiving of the Holy Spirit when he comes at the moment of salvation. That's been placed or baptized into Christ for the forgiveness of sins. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is to you and to your children and to all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call. Every believer is equipped with the same Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, you don't get him in pieces. He's a person. So you get all of him. And all of us have all of him, or we don't have any of him. So we have the same Spirit, the same indwelling, the same sealing of the Spirit of God. Now, how is the grace of God ever going to be extended to the world? Through gifts. And I want you to understand that the word gift is the word charisma. It means extension of grace. So every one of you have the Holy Spirit, and he intends for you to become an extension of God's grace to the rest of the world. That's why you've been equipped already with the Spirit of God. So the church needs to help people understand this truth and to help them not to be misled into thinking that somehow they're unqualified. Every Christian is qualified to serve. And many hurting people around us, all they need to know right now is the love. And then along with that love, that someone's going to listen and somebody's going to care about them. And it doesn't take a professional to love somebody. It doesn't take a professional to listen to somebody. It doesn't take a professional to care about somebody. And we talked about how we got to get out of this professional ministry. We just keep adding professionals. And after a while, we have 7, 8, 9, 10, 20, 30 professionals doing the work. And everybody else is spectators watching them do the work. We must not take the ministry away from the people God intended to do it and who he has equipped to do it. So we cannot confine the operation of the spiritual gifts and the extension of this grace to the sanctuary. Nor can we simply leave it in the hands of the professionals. Look around you a minute. Go ahead, you can look around. Some of you can't even turn your head. Look around. You are already equipped with the Spirit of God. All believers are equipped. And you have the gift of being an extension of God's grace to that world around you. Wherever you're going, you're taking that grace and that extension of the Holy Spirit with you. You're equipped with the Holy Spirit. Second, you're equipped in the Word. Not only are we equipped in the Spirit, we're equipped in the Word. Let's go to 2 Timothy. And please turn to these passages of Scripture. I'm going to tell you why that's important in just a minute. And it's going to maybe tie into my dream. I don't know. God, whatever you're doing, you do it. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. Does it say some Scripture or part of the Scriptures or the Scriptures we choose? What does it say? All Scripture is given by inspiration. God breathed it. And is profitable for, notice this, doctrine. That's the teaching, what we should be walking in. For reproof, where we've gotten off the path. Correction, where we need to get back on the path. And continued instruction. Let me tell you, when you get off the path with God, He doesn't set you down the road somewhere. You're listening to God's Word, and then He reproves you because you're off the path. Correction, He brings you right back where He got off. Somehow we think we're further down the road. No, and the more loops you make, the less direction you're going, the less distance you're covering. Does that make sense? So those are the four things that the Word of God is equipping you for. Now, beyond the filling of the Holy Spirit, people need to be equipped in the Word of God. Now, I'm going to say something here. Not equipped in good stories or good illustrations, or the show. Equipped in the Word of God. Many people today don't even need to bring their Bibles to church. And probably the only time they open them is on Sunday, and most of the time it's up on the Scripture, so they don't even have to open it and find it. We're losing the equipping of people in the Word of God. They're reading stories, they're watching evangelists on TV, they're watching videos, but they're not in God's Word. You understand what I'm saying? We're in the periphery, but we're not in it ourselves. And we have to get to the place where the church are people learning to apply biblical principles to their lives. I call it life relating the Word of God. Not only reading it, but applying it and applying it to where I live and where I walk the field. Truth has to be communicated to people. That's done by a simple and direct teaching of the Word of God. The Word is what's going to transform lives. Everything else will not transform a life. This is what God will transform lives with. So we begin by teaching people who they are in Jesus Christ, their identity in Christ, that they're a new creation in Christ. And their identity then brings them assurance. So many people don't have assurance of their own salvation. Well, I don't know if I'm saved, so I got to get saved, then I got to get saved again, then I got to get saved again, then I get baptized. I've been baptized three times. I'm not really sure I'm saved. Because we're not equipped them in the Word. 1 John 5, 11, 12 says, this is the record that God's given to us, eternal life, and this life is in His Son. He who has the Son has life, and he who does not have the Son of God does not have life. John says, as many as received Him, to them He gave the right to become the children of God, even to those who believe on His name. I don't need my Bible to quote that. See? Neither do you. If you came in here in a Maserati and you drove your Maserati into the parking lot today and you don't have any gas in it, it's cool, but it won't go anywhere. The gas in our tank is the Holy Spirit's Word, and that's what's going to drive you. And because we're not hiding God's Word, we don't have passion for evangelism. We don't have passion for the souls of men because we're not in the Word of God changing our own life. Well, I can't talk to anybody else because my own life is a mess. See what I'm saying? It's only after the person begins to understand who they are and what they have in Jesus Christ that they will carry out the concepts and the principles and life related to their life. You know what that means? We have to be immersed. We have to be immersed in that Word. The only place where success is ever mentioned in the Bible, it was given to Joshua. This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but you shall meditate day and night that you may be prosperous. and that God may show you his way. Those principles have to become my principles, not the pastors, not the missionaries, not my best friend. It has to become my principles. I have to own it. And there's no way to equip the saints but through the teaching of the Word of God. Only way it's going to get done. So not only are we equipped in the Spirit of God, equipped in the Word of God, the second thing or third thing we got to release people to minister. We got to release people to minister. Now, in order for that to happen, point number one is we're going to have to first have faith in the gospel. Let's go to Romans 1. If you don't have faith in this gospel, you're never going to be able to minister. Look at Romans chapter 1 and see what Paul said. This is Paul, persecutor, killed Christians, hunted them down, meets the Lord, and he gets saved. And this is what he says in Romans chapter 1, verse 16. For. Go back to verse 15, tells you what for is there for. I'm ready to preach the gospel to you who are in Rome. Why? For. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For. Why am I not ashamed of the gospel of Christ? For it is the power of God to salvation. Only power of God to salvation. For everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also for the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. See, the power is in the gospel, not in our presentation, not in our delivery of it. It is in the simple word of God. You're never going to be released to minister if you don't understand and accept the power of this gospel. Our problem is that we don't have enough faith in it. If we just had the faith that Paul had, then we would minister the gospel. Why aren't we ministering the gospel? We're afraid. We don't believe it. We don't think it really has power. Or we'd be changing it. Right? No, some of you don't think so. It's awful quiet in here. I haven't even got to my dream yet. Number two, in order to release people to minister, you have to trust the life of Christ in people. You have to trust the life of Christ in people. And I tell you, we struggle because we distrust the life of Christ in people. And when we do, we don't release people to minister. We try to do it ourselves. I want to tell you something. The only people that don't make any mistakes are those who don't do anything. The only people that don't make any mistakes are those who don't do anything. To say people are untrainable, that no one can do it well enough except me, is your ego problem. It's a perfectionist problem. If we're building people, then we have to let them do by doing. How'd you learn to swim? How'd you learn to ski? How do you learn to snowboard? By doing it. The measure of our success in a church is not necessarily how many people we have, but what is going on with the people we have. I'd rather have 10 people where God is doing something than 100 people where God is not doing anything in their lives. And you can see, I watch these programs, and I love the worship. Man, I'd love to watch this worship, and there are 20, 30,000 people in the audience. My question is, are they life-relating the Word of God? Are they there for the show and to feel good in the worship, but are they memorizing, hiding God's word in their hearts? I don't know. I can't judge that. That might have seemed like a judgment, but I don't know. Numbers aren't the answer. What's happening to those who are here? Jesus only had 10, but something happened with them. I'd rather, if we're going to release people to minister, we must see the church as his church. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 1. We have to see it as his church. Ephesians chapter 1. You with me? Are you with me? Are you turning in your Bibles? Good. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 23. verse 22 says, God put all things under his, Jesus' feet, and gave him to be head over all things in the church, which is whose body? His body. The fullness of him. See, this body, there should be no distinction between how we see the church in the world and the way we see Jesus in the world. Why? Because this is his body, and he's the fullness of it, and it should look like just like Jesus, who fills all in all. Look at Matthew 16. Matthew 16. It's fun to do this in the summertime because you can stay air-conditioned by flipping through all these pages. Look at Matthew 16, verse 16. Jesus just asked the question, who do you say that I am? And Peter said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. How many of you would declare that Jesus Christ is the Christ, the Son of the living God? How many of you would declare that today? All right. Now, Peter did the same thing. And notice what Jesus said. Simon Peter said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus answered and said to him in verse 17, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed that to you. Hey, that question just answered, flesh and blood didn't reveal that to you. Holy Spirit revealed that to you because you've either come to faith in Jesus Christ, and so you can say, I know that he is who he said he was. My Father in heaven revealed that to you, Peter. God revealed that to you that are here today or out there. And I say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. Yeah. Peter's the rock, but what are we? We are being built upon the foundation of the apostles and the apostles, and we are the building. And it takes the same statement from us that it took from Peter, and God is going to build his church on that rock and on that foundation and upon us, and the gates of hell will not prevail. There's my dream. It will not prevail against the church. The church will still remain. The church will still be here doing the work of God. Not inside the building, because this building could be taken away from us like that. You walking, wherever you're walking, God with you is taking God. Now I'm going to get into that at the very end of the message, so hang on. Now, I want you to do something. Because you don't have to perform and you don't have to conform to see the church as his church. It simply means that you have to be set free to minister to people any way that you see the need. So I'm going to do something with you today. And here's what I want you to do. I want you to think of a person's need. As soon as you've got a person's need in mind, I want you to raise your hand so I know you got everybody. You got at least one person's need. And if you're not back in the back room, I'm still waiting for you to see if you got her hand. You got a need? You know a need? You got at least one need of a person that you know about. All right. Now, sorry about that back there. What do you think God wants you to do about it? Right where you are, what do you think God wants you to do about that need you know about? No, I want answers. Fix it. That didn't tell me. He told you specifically what a need was. Now, how are you going to meet that need? Now, here's the good news. You want to hear the good news? You're released to do it. Go do it. You don't need a committee. You don't need a professional telling you. Find a need, ask God how to meet that need, and then be released to go minister that need. That will blow the lid off this church, let me tell you what. Ministry is not inviting people to services and events. Ministry is serving people. Now, you probably know somebody who hates the church but need love. Now, why would you ever invite that person to church? They hate the church. What sense does that make to go invite a person who hates the church to the church? What they need is love. So first, go to them in love. Maybe the person is sick. They don't need an invitation to the church if they're sick. Maybe they need a bowl of soup. Maybe they need you just to come over and ask how you can pray for them. But go. See what I'm saying? The invitations are going to come later. Right now, just go walk the field with them. Remember how we talked about walking the field with Jesus? Here's where we need the Emmanuel principle with us is God. Because God's with you. I know what our parents used to say. We used to say it to our kids. I'm sorry. We did. Can you take Jesus there? What a ridiculous question. You take Jesus there whether you think you're taking him there or not. Jesus is God with us. Now I want us to think about that. He came to us. We didn't come to him. No man seeks after God. God came to us where we were, and he brought God to us. Now, I want to tell you folks, that is what Christianity is. Religion is trying to bring man to God, and it cannot be done. Can't be done. Christianity is bringing God to people. And that has been done and continues to be done. So you know what that means? I'm about ready to wrap this thing up with a couple more verses. You know what that means? This will release you. You don't have to get somebody someplace. You just have to get to them. Can I repeat that? You don't have to get people someplace. All you need to do is to get to them. God touches them as we reach out and touch them. Two more verses and we'll wrap it down. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Verse 19. Now, with the previous verse tells us that we've been made right and reconciled to God. Now it says that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. Why did God send Jesus to reconcile the world to God? Because man can't reconcile himself with God, so he has to come. Not imputing their trespasses to them. He's committed to us the word. What is that? That's this right here. You've got to speak this word of reconciliation. That's how God is going to draw man to himself. If you don't speak it, you say, oh, I just have to live it. I just have to love. Yeah, yeah, that's true. That's the initial start. But at some point, this has got to be spoken. It's a word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors. What's an ambassador? It represents one country to another. We represent God to the people. As though God was pleading through us. Be reconciled. That's our message. Be reconciled to God. Now go to John 20. Last verse of scripture to turn to, John chapter 20, verse 21. So Jesus said to them again, peace to you. When did he speak this? When he appeared after his resurrection. Second time he says it in this chapter, peace be to you. Now, he doesn't leave it there. As the Father has sent me. How many of you believe the Father sent Jesus? Amen. Yeah. Well, it's just as real. It just as true that he sent you. As the Father has sent me, so I'm sending you. All of us have been given this ministry of reconciliation. We don't have to wait for the community to come to church. Jesus healed people. He taught them. He loved them. He shared life with them. He gave direction to them. He showed them a better way, truth, and life, and all without a building. Jesus didn't bring them someplace. He went seeking. He went walking the field. See what I'm saying? Can you imagine if each one in this room went out and walked the field this week with the mission of reconciling man to God? Well, I'm not equipped. Yes, you are. You have the Spirit of God. I'm not equipped. Then get in the Word of God, get immersed, so you have something to say and share. See? When this church and others learn who they are in Christ and they get released to minister, they will minister. Let's pray. Well, the battle is coming, but we're not here to throw in the towel. To just wait for the sweet by and by when Jesus comes. We're here to be engaged. Engaged in the culture. Not becoming the culture, transforming the culture. I'm not responsible for somebody else's, where they live, their neighborhood, where they work. I'm not responsible. They are. They're the ministers. They're the priests. You've equipped them with your Spirit. You've equipped them with your Word. Lord, I pray that sometime this week, everyone here, whether they're here or out listening to it, will have your Spirit point out a need in somebody's life. And then that you would reveal to them how they can meet that need. It might just be taking a bowl of soup. It might be just handing some socks. It may be just giving them a meal. I don't know what it's going to be, but you're going to reveal that to them. And then, Father, help them to just go do it and find out that they're not misled to thinking that they're not qualified, because they are qualified. Thank you, Jesus, for walking the field with us. Coming to us where you found us and bringing you to yourself. And as the Father sent you, so now you're sending us. Help us, Lord, to not shrink from that. Be afraid of that. That we might believe like Paul in the power of the gospel. It's a power and a salvation to everyone who believes. Father, we've given up a lot of ground. And it's time we took some of it back. Your armor is not intended for us to retreat, but to stand and face the enemy. Everything is defensive, except one thing, the sword, the Word. Teach us how to be swordsmen, swordswomen, sword children, to know how to wield the sword. Now, Lord, we're walking away from this series. Next week we'll be into Judges. You're showing us what you want for us, what you desire for us, how you will meet us at our points of need. If there's anyone here that's never put their faith and trust in you, that they might know that Jesus Christ came as a Son of God to die for their sin on the cross, and that they can receive him as their Savior and Lord, and have the forgiveness of their sin, and start a new life, a different life. Maybe they've tried everything else and it hasn't worked. Give Jesus a chance. For those of us who've received Jesus, How many more days are we going to have? How much time do we have? Now, carpe diem, seize the day. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're called to go out into this world, and sometimes it can be a scary thing. But like this next song is about to tell us and that we're about to sing, we have a great and mighty King. If God is for us, who can stand against us? Amen?
Amen.
Let's stand and worship Him.
Delivered all our hearts from fear. Our hope is here. You came to make a way, Jesus. You came to raise the dead to life. Our song will rise. Oh, great and mighty King, you reign in majesty. Before your throne we sing, oh. Our offering, our hearts before the risen Lord. All power in your name, Jesus, the one who saves, be lifted high. Our song will rise. Oh, great and mighty King, you reign in majesty. Before your throne we sing, oh. Shout unending praise forever, hallelujah, forever, hallelujah. Your glory fills this place. We shout unending praise forever, hallelujah, forever, hallelujah. Your glory fills this place. We shout unending praise forever, hallelujah.
God bless you. Make sure you're in the Word this week. All right? Let's do that. May you have a great week.